With regard to Article 7 of the Maryland Declaration of Rights, the 2021 congressional plan, the plaintiffs, based upon the evidence adduced at trial, I love these legal terms, proved that the 2021 plan was drawn with partisanship as a predominant intent to the exclusion of traditional redistricting criteria. That is page 93 of the 94-page decision written by Judge Lynn Battaglia, who was formerly with the Maryland Court of Appeals, the highest court in the state. She's now a retired judge, but they bring them out occasionally to hear lawsuits like this. When it came to the lawsuit jointly filed, Bryan, by Delegates Kathy Szeliga and Delegate Neil Peart, Republicans, against the Maryland Congressional, this is the one of eight members of Congress plan, and she threw it out. She said it was extremely, not just gerrymandered, extremely gerrymandered.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's huge, the fact that you have a Democrat judge who has said, yeah, this is wrong. This is, everybody knows this is wrong. It's terrible. It's not just gerrymandered. It's extreme gerrymandering. So we need to make a new map. So, all right.
What does this mean?
I have to say that I was surprised at this. I thought it was going to stay and they're going to get what they wanted. They're trying to even crowd out even more. They said, just, you know, 2010, that map was great, but hold my beer. Let me show you what I can do in 2020.
You know what hurt and what was presented at court? The Princeton gerrymandering project. And the fact that you had these folks their whole history is looking at redistricting maps all over the country, not just Maryland, all over the country. And they looked at four maps that were drawn by the Democrats in Annapolis. And all four of them got an F.
So
great. A through F, all four of them.
It shows you, and it should show nationally, that this is done when you have parties that have all of this power and they want more of it because it's never good enough. They want to get redder, they want to get bluer. And it doesn't matter if it's a Democrat or a Republican,
Absolutely. They're
trying to kind of do these things.
Judge Battaglia wrote that. In her opinion, she said it happens on both sides.
Yeah, it does. I mean, we've seen it in North Carolina, yep. We've seen it in Texas, we've seen it in some other states as well, and we've seen it here in Maryland on the blue side of things. So, you know, the judge has said these things. Now who gets to redraw them? It goes right back to the same drunk people that did it before, the people drunk with power.
But I'm telling you, particularly if it's anything like the legislative map, first of all, this is the first time everybody in history Maryland's done this. So we're operating on new ground, just like in 2002 when the Court of Appeals threw out the legislative redistricting map. That's the process I was a part of. It was new territory. So the question is, what do we do now? Okay, it's thrown out. The court decided itself to draw the map, bringing in its own demographers to do that. Now, maybe that's what will happen in this instance. I don't know. But the bottom line is, everybody, April the 15th is the filing deadline.
Yeah, I think so.
And then July 19th is the election. I don't see that happening.
I don't see it happening either. There's no way it can happen. I mean, we don't even have the maps yet. So how can you have a primary if you don't even have the maps at this point?
Exactly.
Some of these candidates may rethink where they want to go or where it actually is going to be. So, I'm not a lawyer. But I do have to question if it is under the state constitution where these maps are drawn by the legislative body, how can you just have some, you know,
say when the court does anything else it wants to do. When the court says I want to do it, they do it. Particularly if it's never happened before. It's not like we're guided by precedent. There's no precedent for this. Let's go to one of the lead plaintiffs in this case, Maryland Delegate Kathy Szeliga, who joins us right now. Delegate, you and Delegate Peart must be feeling good now about your filing this lawsuit.
Well, we were overjoyed. And as you two were just, you know, chatting, a little surprised at how strongly the judge weighed in our favor.
Well, let me ask you this, Delegate Kathy Szeliga, and we'll get to the merit of the map, but you know full well that everybody was looking at your response to this on social media that you have since, of course, apologized for, but just your reaction to what was going on and Democrats' reaction, if you can talk about that.
Well, obviously, anybody that was following my very poorly executed text message that turned into a retweet that was just totally inappropriate. As soon as somebody called me and said, did you mean to tweet this? And I said, no, that was a private message. I deleted it and apologized immediately. And really, C4 and Bryan, the bigger problem was it overshadowed, in some cases, actually the merits of the case. And that's what's really earth-shattering is we have a precedent-setting decision here from Judge Battaglia that threw the maps out, called them unconstitutional, and said they used extreme gerrymandering and called them an outlier. So, you know, that's certainly great for the citizens across our state, because a third grader can look at those maps and know there's something wrong with them, right?
Exactly.
All right, so what does it mean now that, as you understand it, you know, these maps have to be redrawn? I mean, the time is ticking here. We're already basically into April. We've got filing deadlines. We've got people who've got to determine where they're going to run. Like, how long and how do you think this thing is going to be redrawn?
Well, you know, certainly I'll give you an educated guess.
Sure.
As you've heard me say before, my magic eight ball doesn't always work right. So, but the judge in her decision told the legislature they have 5 days if they want to submit another map. So I understand that the Democrats are busy working on another map. Clearly, the one that they drew that was unconstitutional, while they used the word, quote, transparent, it was not transparently drawn. You know, you can look at what the Governor Hogan's commission did.
Mm-hmm.
They invited the public in. When they literally drew the maps, people were listening in on the Zoom call. So it was completely transparent. So the Democrats are going to try to push another map out this week. You know, I can't imagine when their press release that I, you know, inadvertently responded to so poorly. Basically, they said we still thought the map was okay.
Of course they did. It's same,
so,
it's the same thing in 2002, Delegate, when the Court of Appeals threw out the map that I was a part of. They said Mike Miller and at times Speaker Casper Taylor said the same thing back then.
Did they really?
Oh, absolutely.
See, I remember following that, but clearly not as closely, because you were a plaintiff in that. You were directly impacted by that. But, yeah, their response was, oh, we used the maps from last time, and they passed constitutional muster, so we don't know why this didn't, but we'll give it another try. So I certainly hope that they bring in transparency and fairness and listen to the judge's response and ruling on this case. But, you know, I hope they do, but if in the case that they don't, of course, our side will look at it and you know, take it back to court.
Well, Delegate Kathy, they don't have to do anything other than accept the map that you are referencing that came from three Democrats, three Republicans, three independents that made up the governor's commission, spent all that time, as you said, public hearings all over the state to put together a map, Bryan and Delegate Kathy, that got an A rating from the Princeton Gerrymandering Project. So you have it. It's right there. Just use that and we can move forward.
I believe you're right, and I think the court would accept that, and, you know, it would be right and fair. But the problem with that map is it gives Republicans two seats and a third purple district. So, you know, I don't think that the Democrats want to do that. Clearly, they, you know, ousted Roscoe Bartlett in the last redistricting 10 years ago, and this one they're trying to get rid of Andy Harris. Or, you know, I'll just use that name. Clearly,
right, sure.
The last Republican seat that citizens understand is held by Andy Harris. I hope they do the right thing, but, you know, if history is any indication, I'm not sure they will.
Well, courts are there to make sure they do the right thing, as you found out firsthand.
Yeah, yes. And, you know, her decision, 8 pages, that the last 6 pages are her summary of the case, was, again, very strong, you know, using the words extreme gerrymandering, you know, extreme outlier. They compared the districts in Maryland to districts in other states to, you know, what is compact, what is contiguous, you know, the parameters they're supposed to use. And, you know, again, a third grader can look at that map that, you know, it looks like they drew a Tyrannosaurus beast,
yeah,
a Tyrannosaurus,
yeah,
Rex this time,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, the old one did too, though. That's why, I mean, some of us were surprised at this. So real quick then, on the other map, the legislative map, I mean, where does that stand? And, you know, how much of an issue is that going to be if that one is thrown out?
So I'm involved in that case as well. I'm not the lead plaintiff in the legislative map, but the hearing was last week. And I did actually go to the Court of Appeals. And C4, did you go to the Court of Appeals for your hearing?
Absolutely.
So yeah, Senator Stone, it is.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, go ahead. So did Senator Stone.
Senator Stone and Senator Stolzfus from Eastern Shore. Go ahead.
Yeah, it was, you know, pretty cool. I'll say that. You know, I'd never been in the Court of Appeals before. And so it was pretty cool to be there and be a part of history making. And we feel really good about that case. So the Judge Wilner, who's reviewing the case, has until April 5th to produce a report for the Court of Appeals. And so we believe, you know, about April 5th, maybe on that date, he will produce this report. We're very hopeful that, again, they used a lot of the same data metrics in comparing the legislative maps that they did on the congressional. And we're hopeful that the Court of Appeals will, find in our favor, Judge Wilner first, and then the Court of Appeals, you know, finally to weigh in on our behalf. But I think they're going to have to change the candidate filing deadline again.
They have to.
No doubt about it.
Delegates. It's always great, Delegate, to get you on board, and congratulations to you and Delegate Parrott, because what you did only was hold up what Judge Lynn Battaglia said, the constitutionality of the issue. It wasn't personal. It was just what was done was unconstitutional.
Absolutely. It's not personal. It's for the citizens of our great state. The citizens of our state deserve fair and free elections, and they deserve fair districts.
Well, Delegate Kathy, I want you to know it's my kids that keep me straight with social media. So just next time, check in with the kids.
Oh my gosh, I can't. You can imagine C4 how.
Well, I know you, and I know what would have happened. So I knew as soon as I saw it, and I know it's not Delegate Kathy. So you go ahead, Delegate, and take care. Okay.
All right. Thanks, guys. Have a good day.
I appreciate it.